I've been editing my paper, trying to keep out all the things that have already been said. And at the end, I finished with my title and the final prayer. So I decided it's better to read the paper as it was prepared. And hopefully you don't mind some repetition. Some of the things I am going to say have been already mentioned and discussed a little bit. But have you ever wondered why John the Baptist has not been the favorite saint of prosperity theology preachers? John the Baptist's gospel is this one: commit yourself fully to God, serve God unconditionally, and get beheaded. In prosperity theology lingos, we could say, well, let's sow your seed for God several times, made a covenant with God, and they don't have a category for that. There is nothing in prosperity theology that would explain what happened to John. However, Jesus considered John the Baptist the greatest man ever. He had a lot of respect for his cousin, and he set up John as an example for his disciples. However, for prosperity theology preachers, John's life goes exactly against their get rich, be happy forever message. Instead, for prosperity theology, I would say the model would be the successful farmer who had to build new storage for the crops, for his crops. That farmer's life, if you remember the parable, is a dream come true for prosperity theology. The message of wealth and happiness that we hear so often these days. John the Baptist represents for prosperity theology a failure. The farmer is the perfect example. But for Jesus, John was the winner, the farmer was the loser. So how is it that for us today, our worldview has led us to reject John the Baptist and embrace the rich farmer, albeit Jesus' opinion? When did we change our Christianity for a happy meal? What made us swap our Bibles for secular self-improvement programs? Well, all of this is a complex phenomenon that, as we have seen these days, has a lot of political, economical, sociological, psychological, spiritual elements. And so what I want to do is a little bit of a theological, a little bit of history about the situation in Latin America, and then a little bit of theology about what I see are the main weaknesses in the prosperity theology preachers or preaching. So a little bit of history. In the past, in Latin America, many pastors and writers have pointed out the lack of theological development of the Latin American evangelicals of all denominations, including the mainline churches. Historically, theology was considered secondary to action. There is a whole continent to win for Christ. We have no time for theology. That was the idea. So, furthermore, they say, well, theology was already done in North America and Europe. What else do we need? So this pragmatic approach served its purpose at the beginnings of the church. However, soon it became clear that evangelicals in Latin America needed to think through their faith in order to address the questions, situations, and cultures of the continent. For example, the great Mexican writer, journalist, and theologian Gonzalo Báez Camargo asked in 1929, early in the century, 20th century, he said, maybe our Protestantism does not adapt well to the temperament of these people. It does not satisfy their religious aspiration. Neither does it fulfill their spiritual needs. In a word, it does not take roots. It does not stick. It does not identify with them. He concluded that perhaps we have been unable to connect with our people. And so he proposed to Latinize. That's the words he used, Latinize. I don't know any better expression in English. Latinize Protestantism in Latin America. But what he was saying reflects the fact that evangelical faith came to Latin America from abroad. And from the get-go, Latin American evangelicals received a theology packed in European or North American boxes. We translated those theologies, we copied them, memorized them, and taught them as sacred. We worried little with the question of how to Latinize the Christianity. It became very comfortable just to repeat those theologies. We were very good copycats. Wherever came from abroad, also we said, is surely better than our local product. But later in the century, a lot of people took notice of Bias's agenda to Latinize our faith. It was not an easy process to overcome the many bumps and hurdles. However, those efforts fell on hard soil, tiny seeds wishing to grow. Contextual evangelical theology taking root, a wonderful idea, but it did not happen. The enticement of foreign theologies and foreign largesse, I would say, overpower. There were evangelical theological proposals that biblically address our issues of poverty, corruption, injustice, income inequality, and other issues. The question have been asked several times here that we haven't been good producing good biblical answers for poverty. Well, there are a lot of answers in the literature from Latin American theologians, only that we don't like them. Most evangelicals did not pay attention to them, to those theologians, because those ideas did not come from abroad. So I would say that the first answer to the question though why prosperity theology have been adopted even by conservative evangelicals is that they have lacked theological depth that would have protected them from accepting such gross distortions of the gospel. Theology is made and prepared in capitalistic affluent societies did not and could not prepare Latin Americans to combat trends like prosperity theologies. I think that we need, in order to regain our ground and return to the true biblical evangelical faith, we need to overcome our theological illiteracy and become theologically wise. We cannot afford to remain ignorant theologically. So I want to outline a few of the main theological issues that I see are deficient in prosperity theology. The first one is that prosperity theology has dethroned Christ, the Christology, and somebody else have talked about that here. Christ has been removed from the right hand of God and has become our servant. He is not the Lord of the universe and the head of the church anymore. He exists in prosperity theology only to fulfill my dreams, to attain my needs, to take my orders and grant my wishes. He has no other purpose than to be ready to take the orders and do exactly as we tell him. And as you can hear, the prosperity goals per preaching saying, well, that's the what you need to do. For prosperity theology, Christ is mostly an investment broker in charge of a celestial bank guaranteeing good profits to investors. But this is not the Christ of the Bible. Argentinian Methodist theologian Jose Miguez said that a reduced Christ will always result in a reduced Christianity and a rachitic weakness. Prosperity theology's Christology has left our people with our powerless Christ. They propose a faith that we control, a deity that we manipulate. And as we mentioned before, this is similar to animistic or pantheistic religions, where the gods exist to give us what we want because we perform some rituals which are supposed to appease them and to convince them to act in our favor. But the Christ of the Bible is not such a little puppet. He is the sovereign Lord of the universe, the firstborn of all creation. His power is limitless. His actions do not depend in any shape or form upon us. He acts alone. We need to recover the majesty of Jesus Christ. Our only response to him is to kneel down and confess that he is the Lord, and by his grace we are his servants. Prosperity theology has confused the roles in our relationship with Jesus. For them, he is our slave, but for the Bible, it's the other way around. The prayer should not be, Jesus, I am sowing this much, and you better give me back 100% times more. Rather, is everything I have, everything I am, everything is yours. Not my will, but your will be done. The second issue is about soteriology. Prosperity theology has redefined soteriology. Salvation is material, not spiritual. Salvation is to be free from having little and to getting more. Hell is poverty, heaven is wealth. Salvation is achieved by giving to the church. In prosperity theology's soteriology, there is no need for the cross of Christ, no need for grace, no need for repentance or conversion. There are no demands for developing a Christ-like character, leaving behind worldly ways of life. There is no eternal punishment for sinners, no hope for an impending return of Christ. The only salvation offered by prosperity theology preachers is about getting wealthy. The Savior is an investment firm. The church is the banking venue. The preacher is your financial advisor. You save yourself depending on how much money you give. So, prosperity theology has really another gospel of salvation. The sin is to be poor. This is the gospel that they preach. The sinner's predicament separates them from God's blessing. The way to God, or to get to God, is to be is by positive thinking and positive declarations of change. The only way to be saved is by sowing seeds, that means money, at the church. The fruits of salvation is the many things that you receive in material ways, and Christian life is equated with being wealthy. And if you don't receive such salvation, the problem might be your lack of faith or that you are not sowing enough. So together with wealth, salvation means to be healthy, happy, and in full enjoyment of this world's amenity. Anything short of that needs to be spoken against by declaring victory loudly and in faith. Otherwise, your salvation is not complete. We could say, as Paul said, "You crazy Galatians, did someone put a hex on you?" That's the message. My paraphrase would say, "You nutheads, what happened to you?" So the idea that we are sinners separated from God, guilty and condemned to eternal damnation, that only through Jesus' sacrifice on the cross and his resurrection we are rescued from sin and its consequences, and that we are called to live in complete submission to God's will, following Jesus' example, is totally foreign to prosperity theology. The third issue is ecclesiology, and we already mentioned some that many times. Prosperity theology has not given us only a different Christ, but it's also a different church. The ecclesiastical model in Latin America is the church as a private company, where a successful and charismatic CEO, or chief executive officer, that means the pastor, has as his main goal to increase profits and assets, that means tithes, offerings, radio and television stations, buildings, etc., by enticing more customers, that means the members of the church, to buy its product, that means the message. And in this model, the strategy to market religious services becomes superlative, and people are secondary. And as somebody mentioned also, we see the return of a highly clerical model with a few anointed ones who claim to have exclusive access to an endless source of power. They dispense some favors to the lay people who have fulfilled some religious rite, and in this case is a monetary offering. Our ecclesiology is in serious need of redefinition. Nowadays, anyone with the technical knowledge could start a church and make it grow, just by applying the model without any spiritual influence. You don't need prayer, you don't need the guidance of the Holy Spirit, you don't even need the Bible to become a mega church. Just use the manual, follow the exact steps, and you have a church. You only have to learn the lingo, the style, and the template. You don't even have to be a believer. So the ecclesiology of prosperity theology has turned people into religious consumers without any ethical commitments. And we have a lot of people going to church, but no real discipleship. And one of the situations is that in the ecclesiastical marketing of prosperity theology, those who cannot buy their products are excluded. The marginalized, the people with disabilities, the elderly and unemployed among others, are kept at bay because they do not have any means to participate in the financial system that keeps prosperity theology churches going. It's a church without compassion. Now, as we have seen here, that can be also contested, but we'll leave that for the questions. We need to rediscover the biblical model for the Christian community. The church should not be the private property of a religious entrepreneur. The church is God's people, called by him to be his instrument to manifest his kingdom in society. It is the community of those who have become, by the work of the Holy Spirit, a new creation with the power to be God's agents of transformation. The church is the light and the salt of the earth. It should provide the environment for people to experience God's salvation, God's justice, and God's redemption of the whole creation. God has not given up his property exclusivity of his church. There is no room in the kingdom of God for another king. Now, the last issue has to do with the Bible, and we have talked a little bit about that here too. But prosperity theology have changed the Bible for people's theories and ideas. And sadly, this is true not only in prosperity theology churches, but also in many other evangelical churches. Most evangelical liturgies today, in Latin America at least, they don't include Bible readings anymore. And most churchgoers do not have the discipline of reading and studying the Bible in their homes and private life. And this has been a constant concern for Latin America, that the Bible illiteracy is the norm. The argument could be made that prosperity theology preachers find their ideas in the Bible, as we see that they use the Bible too. That is all a matter of interpretation. And that's actually a more serious issue. In postmodern hermeneutics, as you know, the reader has control over meaning. That is, that any text can mean whatever the reader decides. Until recently, finding the author's intention has been the hermeneutical key for biblical interpretation. The idea used to be that you come to the Bible to find what God wanted to tell us, since God is the author of the Bible. However, in prosperity theology, the idea is that the preacher decides what the Bible means. What we hear in their preaching is an imposed meaning over the text, a meaning that supports the preacher's ideas and agendas. People go to church thirsty for God's words, and they only receive lies. And here we need to remember that there is only one infallible word, the Bible. All other words, regardless of who speaks them, are not to be equated to God's word. We need leaders who give the Bible the centrality it has lost in many so-called churches in Latin America. The people of God need to re-encounter the Bible, and their leaders are the ones who should lead them to do so. Everyone, even the pastor, needs to submit to the Bible's authority. It is the Word of God that has the power to change lives. And it is not only sad, but tragic, when the Bible is replaced by human opinions. The biblical model is not a church centered in the leader, but the leaders and the congregation together center in and under the Bible. We need more Bible and less human words. So we need to acknowledge that Latin America needs the real, true gospel, not fake gospels. Our continent needs Jesus, the real Jesus, not pseudo-preachers with big names and checkbooks. Our people need the Word of God, not counterfeit messages brought by religious gangsters. The message for Latin America today ought to be incarnated within the social reality of our people, sensitive to human needs and historical processes, faithful to the whole biblical revelation, committed, compassionate, saturated with the ethics of the kingdom of God, in the power of the Holy Spirit, hungry and thirsty for justice, centered on the cross, and consistent with our lifestyle. It has to be a message without dichotomies between evangelism and social action, spiritual and material, body and soul, individual and social, private and public, present and future. Those are dichotomies that we see often. Only then, when we get that message, will the true gospel be able to transform our continent, and only then will the church become an instrument of God's, in God's hands, for the transformation and restoration of all things.